Some of the challenges for thorium molten salt reactors, and this is going to be somewhat more practical, looking into the materials and processes, because can we actually build this thing? I mean, trying to look at some of the more, you can say, engineering challenges related with this thing. I have a background as chemical engineer and a PhD in material science and electrochemistry, and I've been working 20 years with industrial research and with smaller startups for the last 10-15 years. And what I'm going to talk about is a brief introduction to Copenhagen Atomics, some of the challenges that this new technology, or you can say old technology, is facing, and a bit what are we doing to address these things in the Copenhagen Atomics. So we should have been a different presentation. Nevertheless, okay. Thomas formed this meetup about thorium back in autumn 2013 in order to sort of like gather the thorium community in Denmark. And it actually worked quite well. A lot of people have joined the meetup. There was this waste burner concept in a container that was formulated as a concept. There was a white paper written, and there was this proposal for the competition in the UK last year in the winter. And then also at that time, the group was split into Copenhagen Atomics and to Seaborg Technology. And subsequently we formed Copenhagen Atomics as a former company. And the purpose, Thomas said it is to develop technologies for thorium-based breeder reactors and to reduce nuclear waste. And of course the long-term goal is to develop and contribute to the development of a waste burner. So if we look at the challenges, public awareness, we have dealt with that, I will not say a lot more. Then there's reactor design. We have seen reactor designs both from Kirk, Thomas presented a little bit from Samofar. So I will focus on the materials and processes for the molten salt reactor. And this is a schematic of the molten salt reactor. It could actually be this schematic or any of the previous schematics that it's shown during the day. It shows a reactor, there is a reactor melt, it could be lithium fluoride, it could be a chloride and so on. And the first thing that people say, and that is also a lot of the responses that Thomas get on the block, is that, oh, but this will never work. You have a fluoride melt at 700 degrees C, it will eat away your metal in a fraction of a second. Okay, then the next problem is that you have a cooling loop, which is also based on a fluoride salt, this mixture of sodium, lithium, and potassium fluoride. Huh, same shit. It will also be eaten away. Then we need some kind of reprocessing. We have heard about the neutron efficiency from the speakers here today. So we need to do something about the melt, and you can say improve the qualities of the melt. Okay, so that's a new impossible invention we need for getting this to work. And then there's all the other challenges with the public awareness and how actually to design the reactor. And what we do in Copenhagen Atomics is actually to look at these problems. So if we take the material issues first, we have heard a lot from this seminar in the Netherlands in April last year. And there was an excellent presentation by Dirk looking at effects of radiation and corrosion with these materials, and there's a direct link to his presentation, and he showed this microscope photograph. Up here we have the melt, then we see massive corrosion and depletion of chromium, and then we see all sorts of defects in the base or core of the material. This up here is due to the corrosion. Down here is to thermal effect and radiation. This study was done at 850 degrees C. We will look at somewhat lower temperatures. I think people operate these reactors around 750 degrees C. So how do we explain this corrosion? From his presentation, you can actually not see it, but he went through it, and we have also seen this, that these fluorides that we have in the melt are very stable. The lower the formation of energy, the more stable the fluorides are. These are the elements from the construction materials, and we can see that they are orders of magnitude less stable. So how can we then explain the corrosion thing? Well, on all stainless steel types, you have the formation of a surface oxide that prevents and passivates the steel, preventing further corrosion to go down into the base material. And this reaction here is absolutely possible. I mean, that will take place. But now we are dealing with a reactor. So where does this chromium oxide come from, apart from the initial chromium oxide? Because you have a closed system, you don't really want anything to enter, oxygen or water or anything to enter, because if things can come in, radioactive species can get out. So if we look at the reactions, you can have the removal of the chromium oxide. That can only happen once with the things that are present initially. This reaction will for sure not occur, as the lithium fluorides are orders of magnitude more stable. And then there is, of course, if you have free fluorine, then you could have corrosion. But he showed on the microscope picture that there was really, really severe corrosion. And he actually doesn't explain it in the presentation, but in this one small sentence, that the corrosion was actually due to impurities in the melt. And that is, of course, if you have oxygen or water entering, that will react violently. We are talking 700 degrees C. And then you can have all this corrosion. A second experience in this relation, I did my industrial PhD at Danfoss, and at the same lab where I was doing my industrial PhD, they were also working with deposition of tantalum from phenite melts at 700 degrees C. And that was done in a super well-controlled atmosphere. It worked for years. It was in a graphite crucible with a stainless steel casing. And then after about roughly 5 years, the heating element stopped working and we had to take everything apart. And big surprise, when you looked at the metal casing, all the fluoride belt has completely dissolved the graphite crucible, but there was absolutely no signs of corrosion on the steel casing. And then as engineers, you get curious, why is this? And you do a little bit of electrochemistry, and then you can see that stainless steel is absolutely stable in Fleenach melts at 700 degrees C in the normal potential window, as long as you don't have water and oxygen. So if we should sum up for the materials, we do have the materials. Hastelloy-N will work, stainless steel will work for the cooling loop, given that we don't mix in water. But that shouldn't be too much of a problem, given that we have a closed system to keep the radioactive species from being spread to the surrounding environment. Then there's two challenges. We have a fluoride-based system. We feed in something that we have fluorinated. We have fission products and decay products. And during the fission and the decay, we actually have free fluorine. So the free fluorine will react with the reactor materials. So that's a challenge. But that's something that you have to control by controlling the chemical composition of the melt so that you keep the activity of fluorine in the melt low. And that's an engineering challenge. It's not something where we have to invent some super duper or fancy type of construction material. We have the materials, we just have to treat the melt properly. And that brings us to the next thing that we are working with, these subsystems for the reactor, how to do this. We have a little bit of activity. We have seen in Kirk's presentation the flame reactor. I'll just touch briefly upon that. Then there's the need for reprocessing of the of the reactor melt in order to remove fission products, in order to have a high neutron efficiency, and also for keeping the activity of fluorine in the melt low, so that the fluorine don't eat away our construction materials. And finally, control system for optimizing and controlling the chemical composition. You need some kind of control system in order to do your reprocessing and controlling of the melt in an intelligent way. This is just an example of a flame reactor where you fluorinate these things to separate away the uranium, and then you have these compounds here that you can then burn in your waste burner. What traditional nuclear industry does is then going through oxidation and wet chemistry of these highly radioactive things. We can skip that, but we don't have to invent new stuff. This flame reactor, go to Hitachi, and they have a device that you can use for this. Then the reprocessing. Why remove the fission products? And the reason has been given during a number of the presentations. You need to remove species that can absorb neutrons, because that will hamper your neutron efficiency, and then you will not have a breeder reactor. And we have made this, you can say, super simple setup in Copenhagen Atomics. We have a furnace, a reactor, vacuum equipment, and protective gases. So we can actually, mimic the conditions that we will have during the reprocessing of the reactor salt. And it's those designing, okay, if we want to do this in an intelligent way in the reprocessing system, we will need these times, temperatures, atmospheres, pressures, and all that is needed in order to have the high neutron efficiency and to prevent corrosion. Secondly, we can also use this equipment to make salt samples, reactor salt samples with known chemical compositions that we need for this chemical control system that I will talk about in a second. So all in all, very, very simple setup, and we have discussed this money thing, and we do this by funding things ourselves and using equipment of good friends and former colleagues. So a lot of collaboration can make a lot of things happening for very, very little money. The control system, why need it? Yeah, well, there's of course always the safety aspects. You need to know what you have in the reactor. You need the information about the chemical composition in order to optimize the melt composition, and also to operate your reprocessing in an efficient manner. The idea that we have used for the chemical analysis is based on laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy. I have worked with this technology for 6-8 years, and it's very, very simple. You take a laser that is slightly more powerful than this one, then you send a laser pulse to the sample, and then it generates a plasma on the sample. You record the light from the sample, and then you do a spectral, send it to a spectrometer, and then you do analysis. The technology is really as simple as that. The challenge is, of course, the interpretation of the information you record. And we have actually worked quite a bit with this. So we have demonstrated that we can actually use this technology to analyze fluoride melts at 700 degrees C. It was not for molten salt thorium reactors, but for cryolite melts for aluminium production. But same, same, but different. We have also used it for analyzing directly on the surface of silicate melts at 1500 degrees C, and proven that we can make very, very accurate chemical analysis. And if you look at the additional features, yeah, you have high spectral resolution of this technology, meaning that you can actually quantify the different isotopes present in your reactor melt. It's a remote sensing. You don't want really to get close to these radioactive samples. With the silicate melt, the analysis was done from a 5-meter distance. So you could do it in the reactor loop, so you don't have to remove melt samples to the external environment and actually do the chemical analysis. It has a low detection limit where you get typically in the order of 10 ppm with no effort, and if you put in an effort, this can go down to a few ppm. It's really, really simple to implement. It's standard laser equipment and some optical fibers, and it's actually fairly inexpensive. And this is just to illustrate. We have measured on thorium, uranium, and lithium fluoride. And this is a metallic thorium sample I'm holding, just so you can see the size of it. So you basically fire the laser. I fire the laser and you do an analysis. It seems like there is a hole in the sample. That is not the case, it's just a miscoloring. But it's just to give you some idea. Then you get this spectrum here of what could look like noise. But if you zoom in on it, you can see here, this is data from literature from uranium-235 and 238, the two isotopes, and we can see those present in this metallic sample. It is by no means, we can say, analytical grade thorium. We have sometimes just have to analyze what you can get your hands on. If you compare with literature, I will not spend a lot of time. This is on thorium oxide and depleted uranium oxide, and it can be a little difficult to see whether this is present in our measurement, but if we merge them, we can actually assign the peaks in the spectrum that we recorded, both to the thorium oxide peaks and the depleted uranium peaks. So we are actually very, very confident that we can also quantify the chemical composition of the melt, including the distribution of isotopes. And that is needed both for controlling the chemistry and operating this efficiently. You can also see the isotope spreading of lithium. This is based measurement on the lithium fluoride. This is literature data, and this is our recordings. So if I should sum up what we are doing at the Copenhagen Atomics, it's this public awareness, and as everybody here has said, acceptance of the technology is the first step towards funding, and I would like to thank Ida again for making this arrangement today, because that's really, really important. And these are the activities that we are working on, and I hope I have been able to communicate that we don't need sort of like quantum leaps on the invention level to make these things work. We have the technologies, we have the materials, and it's a matter of funding is of course a challenge, but you can get a long way with collaboration. And that's also why it's great to see you here also. And by that, thank you for your attention.